If you would have asked me 5 years ago, Rob, where do you see yourself in 5 years on YouTube? The answer would not have been sitting on an apple crate using a posing table to make a YouTube video, but here we are. Today we are rounding out our Westcott versus Godox comparison by comparing their roundhead speedlights. That would be the Westcott FJ80 and the Godox V1, aka the Flashpoint Zoom Lion X. Now both of these are, well, roundhead speedlights. Both have zoom functionality. Both of these are designed that they can go on top of your camera or be used off camera. Both of these have lithium ion batteries. Both of them can be used as a commander to control other identical units or anything else in their respective series. That's the Westcott FJ series or the Godox X series. And both of them have the usual features nowadays, which are TTL, high speed sync, manual control, stroboscopic functions, etc. So, how do these two lights stack up against one another? With their batteries attached, both of these lights are 1.2 pounds. So there's not really any weight difference in using these on top of a camera. In fact, the only size difference is that the Westcott FJ80 is just a little bit taller than the Godox V1, and its head is just a little bit thicker as well. Now I will compare all the usual specs, power, color, things of that nature, but the real story, the real difference between these two lights is their interface. The interface on the back of the light and how you control it. The Westcott FJ80 has a large display, a color display, that is entirely touch screen and it takes up the entire back control of the unit. Whereas the Godox V1 has the very typical speed light display in that you've got a monochromatic display with buttons and dials to control all the functions of the lights. That's the huge difference between these two lights. Now, companies like Profoto have made speed lights with, you know, larger, prettier displays than your average speed light, but nobody's ever gone full touchscreen. Nobody's gone to the point where you are largely avoiding button presses altogether. So the Westcott FJ80 is in kind of a league of its own in that regard.
All right, let's go over some of the pros and cons that come from using that touchscreen on the Westcott FJ80. The first con is the Westcott FJ80 takes forever to turn on. You have to hold the power button, then confirm on screen that you want it on, then it takes a few seconds to initialize. In total, it takes over 7 seconds from starting to turn it on before it's ready to actually fire a flash. By contrast, the Godox V1 takes about 4 seconds. The first pro is what I consider to be a very easy to understand interface. If you hit the home button on the left, you are given 4 very simple options. Speed light for use on camera, host for use as a commander to control other flashes, client to be controlled by another flash or transmitter, and settings where additional menu options can be found. I do dislike the use of the words host and client here, as far as I know, there's nobody else in the industry that uses this language. As for the touchscreen control, it's intuitive, but overall I find it quite slow. Let's start with the speed light menu, where you control the power level by tapping the integer you'd like to adjust and then hitting up and down. I find it requires me to look at the screen, because there is no haptic or physical feedback to confirm that I pressed a button. If I'm looking through the camera viewfinder while adjusting the flash, something I do very often in wedding photography, I have no confidence that my adjustments are accurate. The touchscreen is responsive here, and since you can adjust the full and 10 stop increments, it's still quick to move through the entire power range, at least in this mode. The client menu is also fine. All you are expected to do here is set up the group and channel, and then you're done touching the flash because it will be controlled by another unit. The host or commander menu is where the touchscreen control is the worst. To adjust a group's power, you tap the power level next to the group once. Then you can use the up and down arrow at the bottom to adjust by 10th stops, or you can tap the power level section to increase by a full stop. But notice there's no control to drop by a full stop. That creates a problem when you want to drop the output of a group. Let's say I want to adjust group A from 5 to 3. I have two options. First, I can tap the group and hit the down arrow 20 times, but that's really silly. Or I can tap the power integer 8 times to wrap around the top of the power level and then come back from the bottom of the power range. I just find this completely silly for a simple power drop, and something different should have been done here. Overall, I feel like the interface would be dramatically improved with just a single dial at the bottom below the touchscreen. Or, the touchscreen needs to be high quality enough that you can use sliding bars to adjust the power level, like I do with my office lights on my phone.
Now, one thing I will say that I appreciate on the FJ80 is the addition of groups D, E, and F. So using the V1, I only have access to groups A, B, and C off camera. So I'm limited to a 3-light off camera setup if I'm using that as a master. Whereas this, right out of the gate, I can get 6 off camera lights, which is awesome. Now the second big difference is down here on the shoe. This is the Godox V1S, meaning that it's only compatible with Sony cameras, at least fully compatible. The FJ80, on the other hand, is compatible with all the brands of speed lights. You can put this on a Canon, you can put it on Nikon, a Lumix, Fuji, doesn't matter, it'll work on any of those. The only one that comes with an asterisk is Sony. With Sony, you're required to put this on an adapter, and then that adapter attaches to your camera. As a Sony user, I view this as a negative because it's one more piece that I have to bring along with me, put on top of my camera, and it also just feels weird putting this big old speed light on top of this little tiny adapter that then goes on my camera. I haven't had any issues, but I wouldn't be surprised to break that adapter if I bump this in the least bit. Now, that being said, other people find this to be an advantage because A, if you ever switch lighting brands in the future, you don't have to change your lighting. B, if you happen to use multiple camera systems, maybe you've got a big old professional Canon setup and then you've got a Fuji for personal use, you can still use this and have access to all the features, the TTL, the high speed sync, everything is still gonna work the same. So with this whole universal trigger aspect, as a Sony user, I find it to be negative, but I completely understand pretty much everybody else will view it as a positive. All right, after going over those differences, now we can talk about the tech specs. The V1 is 0.4 of a stop brighter than the FJ80. That's with both of them at their full output. I've tested that in a modifier and direct from the flash tube. In both instances, the V1 was 0.4 of a stop brighter. Now, 0.4 of a stop is not a crazy amount, but it is notable enough for two lights that are of almost identical size. In fact, the V1 being a little bit smaller. Now, I also test the full output to see the range of these lights and see how the output stability is as you move through the different power levels. And the V1 offers a wider range of total outputs and it has more output stability. So it's just more accurate as you drop the light a stop of power, you actually lose a stop of light. When it comes to color, both of these lights vary about the same amount. The V1, plus or minus about 120 Kelvin. The FJ80 is right about that as well. But the FJ80 is considerably better when it comes to color because it is way closer to daylight. The V1, not only does it approach color temperatures closer to cloudy, like all the way up to 6,500 Kelvin, it also has a slight green cast to it, which a lot of people assume is something to do with the lenses that are used in front of here, just offering a slight green cast. A lot of people find the same issue on the 8100 Pro. The FJ80 has no green cast until you get to almost its minimum power levels, and even then, it's a very small green cast, whereas it's pretty considerable on the Godox V1. I also tested the T.1 flash durations of these two lights, and the FJ80 has better T.1 flash durations from full all the way down to 1/16th power, but then the V1 kind of takes over around that 1/32nd power level and then has better T.1 flash durations all the way to its minimum power level. And by the time you get to its minimum power level, the FJ80 was producing 1/12,000th of a second, whereas the V1 is like 1/27,000th or 1/30,000th. So considerably better at minimum power, but I don't really put a lot of weight in that because I don't think anybody buys these strobes expecting to freeze action, at least not in like a portrait sense, because they're just not powerful enough lights. Maybe you could do some cool water droplet stuff with these things really close, but when it comes to using for portraits or trying to freeze action outdoors, it's just not happening with a speed light. Full power flashes, the FJ80 will do 400 full power flashes, and the V1 is closer to 480. Now there's an even bigger gap than that, because if you were to drop the V1's output 0.4 of a stop to match the peak brightness that you can get out of the FJ80, then all of a sudden you're getting like 600-700 flashes out of the V1. So the Godox V1 just gives you significantly more flash power. I also found that operation drain, that is, the flash either being on standby or even being off, the Godox V1 drains way slower than the Westcott FJ80. Are you f***ing kidding me? This thing's almost out of power again. In terms of recycle time, both of these lights recycle full power in 1.2 seconds, so exact same experience there. Both of these lights obviously have a round head and both offer proprietary grids and attachments, gel modifiers, sphere modifiers, and then if you wanted to use them with umbrellas or softboxes, then both require additional mounting equipment such as an S2 bracket. All right, let's go over some of the finer details between these. The first one would be rotation. If you're an event photographer, this is often going to be on your camera and you're going to be turning it left and right to bounce off of different surfaces. The V1, it is extremely tight. Even using these for years, there's still a really tight action, and that's just been consistent on all of the Godox speed lights. The FJ80, way smoother action out of the box, way more comfortable to turn left and right. The Westcott FJ80 has a 1/4-20 thread on the side, which is nice because you can mount it with any very simple tilt adapter that has a 1/4-20 top. And that just allows you to avoid bringing something a little bit bulky like an S bracket, or to avoid mounting on the shoe, which is a weak point of every flash. And really nobody should be mounting their speed lights via the shoe anymore with the other options that are available. But I appreciate the fact that the FJ80 makes it easy with this 1/4-20 attachment on the side. An extremely minor detail, both of these rotate almost identically, but the FJ80 only rotates 90 degrees to the left, whereas the V1 rotates slightly more than 90 degrees, in fact, almost 180 degrees back to the left as well. If that's the reason you picked the V1, I'm really curious to hear your story. All right, so in terms of value, I think these are pretty even because you've got output advantages here and you've got color advantages on the FJ80, and only $30 separating their default prices. Now, I do wanna say, I appreciate what Westcott / Jimbei attempted with the touchscreen display. And I think different people are going to react to it differently. For me, somebody who is almost always using off-camera flash and using multiple off-camera flashes, and doing so in a way that I want it to work fast, I'm not a big fan of the touchscreen. However, I think if you are somebody who is setting up a portrait session and you're kind of setting your lights up once and then you're gonna run with those settings for a while, or you're newer to flash and you're just using this as an on-camera speed light, then I think the touchscreen might actually be really nice because at its core, it's very intuitive, which is nice. It's just without that physical feedback for somebody who likes to work fast, it drives me nuts. I really hope that this is a step towards slider control, because if we had slider control that was accurate on a touchscreen, then I think I'm all in on the touchscreen. All right, I hope I made the differences between these two flashes really clear for you. I've already gone over the 400, I've already gone over the 200. I will wrap up this Westcott versus Godox comparison with a video on the XJ2M trigger, just so you can see what it's like to control all of the Westcott lights from that transmitter. That transmitter has things that I love and things that I hate. So can't wait to break open that video for you. If you guys have any questions, leave them in the comments. Subscribe if you want to see more of my videos. And if this video helped you out, please make sure to hit that like button. All right, take it easy, guys.